We rejoice in the one who leads us beside still waters and gives his refreshment of soul. Christ our shepherd shows us the way we should go, so that the name of God will be glorified. Though all manner of evil befall us, we will not be afraid, for the great shepherd of our souls is with us. We are never away from the love and mercy of the Lord, and we shall be with him for ever and ever. Amen.
Would you join me in prayer, please? Ever-present God, who sees all that we can see and everything that we cannot, we gather in awe of your vision. We give thanks for the creativity that allows us to worship together, though apart. Be with us now in our worship. Awaken us to your holy presence. Calm us. Peel back our layers of anxiety and fear, and allow us to be truly present to your presence in this time. Enliven us to trust fully in your love for us, even as we wonder and question during this difficult time. May we recognize your guidance as we struggle and strive to be who you call each of us to be. Be with us in our worship, in Christ's holy name, amen.
Thank you. Today's Bible verse comes from the book of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 12. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." After saying this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they asked. He replied, "The man they call Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is this man?" they asked him. "I don't know," he said.
This sermon was written by the Reverend Jordan Dickinson for the fourth Sunday in Lent, March 22, 2020, for Grace Church. Psalm 23. The Lord leads me in right paths for his name's sake. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. The Gospel of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 41. Jesus manifests himself as the light of life. Psalm 23 is one of our most beloved psalms. As a song of trust and confidence in God, the 23rd Psalm has been a wellspring of encouragement for Christians and Jews throughout the centuries. God cares for us as a shepherd looks after each of his flock. We turn to these words of comfort and strength as we face the coronavirus, COVID-19. As a congregation, you are doing your part as we seek to limit the spread of this virus that is in our state and around the world. In finding alternatives to coming together for our worship face-to-face, we remember we are a community of faith that is so much more than the building in which we traditionally gather. We listen in Scripture for inspiration and help for today and all the days ahead. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. God provides. The Lord, our shepherd, leads us, his sheep, to things that are good for us. We have vivid images, green pastures, still waters, waters of peace, and right paths, which are the ways of righteousness, of saving justice. He restores my soul, giving us life itself. The psalmist then proclaims, "Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me." The King James Version, which we know so well, translates this phrase as the valley of the shadow of death. It is the valley of extreme darkness, the place of our deepest troubles and fears, the place where we think no one will ever accompany us. The shepherd does not lead us away from this place. Instead, we walk right through it. We face the darkness, but it holds no power over us because we are in the presence of the Lord. The shepherd is aware of the darkness, but to paraphrase Psalm 139, the darkness is not dark to him. There is no experience of darkness or fear where the Lord is not with us. This is a message that we, as a people of faith and as a church, can offer to each other and those in the wider community. Love is the strongest medicine for fear or feeling overwhelmed by events at any time, and certainly now. We know the difference it makes whenever someone truly listens to us when we are in a dark valley. During this time of change and disruption of normal church life, we pray that none of us will miss or cover over others' feelings of being alone or worried or fearful. As people of faith and hope, let us be present to each other in ways that will open up to us each day. The psalm now leads us fully into a realm of people and not sheep. Suddenly, we enter a scene of table fellowship where the Lord sets a table and invites us to dine in the presence of our enemies. At this point, the Lord anoints our heads with oil and offers a cup that is overflowing. What the Lord offers is without limit. It is we who are limited in our ability to receive. The 23rd Psalm concludes with a strong affirmation. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. But these words of comfort seem to clash with reality. We know that almost no one experiences goodness and mercy following them every day of their lives. There's always a mixture of good and evil that follows us. Otherwise, is it not like saying they lived happily ever after? The Hebrew word for follow may also be translated pursue, and that changes the picture a little bit. God's goodness and mercy will chase after us, even if we run in the opposite direction. When a small child trips and skins her knee, a simple kiss from a loving caregiver brings healing. Does the skinned knee go away? No, of course it does not. The physical pain remains, but the offering of love in the form of a caring kiss makes all the difference. In the same way, the 23rd Psalm is about finding life in its truest sense, which is union with the Lord, and discovering that can bring healing to our lives. When we sit at the Lord's table and feel our foreheads anointed, we get a holy kiss that heals our places of hurt. We see the darkness around us lose its power in the midst of the Lord's presence, and we are restored. The gospel reading from John also deals with darkness. Our scripture holds up for us a living and active God through Jesus' healing of the man born blind. A word of background. John, the fourth gospel, was written later in the experience of the early church, close to 90 AD in the Christian era. The temple in Jerusalem had been destroyed by the Romans, and the Jewish population was dispersed throughout the Mediterranean world. Whereas earlier, the followers of Jesus continued to worship at the temple and in synagogues, by the time John's gospel was written, Christians were being excommunicated from these same synagogues. The followers of Jesus, a Jew from Nazareth, began to see the Jews as enemies. Persecuted by emperors and by the society around them, these early Christians lived in a time of conflict and darkness. It is in this context that we have the story of a man born blind receiving his sight. As Jesus and his disciples are walking along, they saw a man blind from birth. In the ancient world, such a situation was often attributed to sin. The disciples asked, "Who sinned? The man or his parents?" Jesus answered that neither sinned, but he was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. Jesus points out the meaning of the healing as the instance of light coming into darkness. This is a story of how a man who sat in darkness was brought to see the light, not only physically, but spiritually. On the other hand, it is also a tale of how the religious leaders who believed they saw clearly were blinding themselves to the light and plunging into darkness. The story starts in verse 1 with a blind man who will gain his sight and ends in verse 41 with the Pharisees who have become spiritually blind. We can suffer from shuttered vision like the neighbors in today's scripture who don't recognize the man they had only known as a blind beggar. A changed life may make any one of us a stranger to others who have known us before. An example is that of a recovering person in sobriety living among those in her or his own family who continue in their addictions. This is not an uncommon situation in which others are blinded by their denial. Whenever we are tempted to panic, As evil and chaos seems out of control in our world, I suggest we look for those who are responding and helping in order to see and not be blinded. Do we live by faith or by unbelief? Can we trust that there are signs of God at work around us? When the people of Rutland welcomed Syrian refugee families in the midst of opposition and challenges from others, many of us nearby saw God at work. The Pharisees, the religiously correct people, were blinded by their concern for the law and its prohibition of working on the Sabbath. This made them unwilling to see the sign of this miraculous healing of the man born blind. Almost everybody fails the man born blind. Even his family backs away from him, and his parents put their own safety before their son's welfare. We can understand an older couple being reluctant to sacrifice their home, work, and community for their son. But would we not expect them to celebrate with him, to be joyful over his healing? In the story in John's Gospel, the parents' fear overwhelms their joy, and they abandon their son to the authorities. The community fails, the religious authorities fail, the family fails. The only trustworthy figures in this story are the man born blind and Jesus. The man tells the truth, and even in the face of threats, he sticks to his guns. I was blind, but now I see. Jesus is the only one the man can trust, and he is the only one we trust. Jesus is the one who transforms and changes the man's life. It is Jesus who heals. Jesus stands with the man in his isolation. He stands with us, too. Sometimes when the sun is really bright or when an artificial light is intense, we need to squint or shut our eyes. The brightness seems dangerous to us, and the reflex is automatic. Metaphorically, we see this human reaction unfolding in the story from John. Jesus, as the light of the world, shines bright, and the neighbors, the religious authorities, and the man's family shut their eyes in self-defense. However, the light of the world is in our midst, and we need not shut our eyes. In fact, the best thing to do is open our eyes wide. We will not be blinded by the light. We will be saved and made whole. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Amen.
Thank you.
Join me in prayer, please. Gracious and wonderful God, hear us on this new day in this new way. We come with grateful hearts to give thanks for the blessings that are ours, even and perhaps especially in this chaotic time. We thank you for this place, this beautiful part of your world, where we can enjoy and appreciate green pastures and still waters. We give thanks that your rod and your staff do comfort us, and that you give us wisdom to be guided by your word. We ask that you would be with all the decision makers around the world, and especially at this time in our history, we ask that you guide the leaders of this country and this state and the leadership of our cities, towns, and villages. Give them steady strength and perseverance in the face of difficult, sometimes life and death decisions. Healing God, be with those already afflicted with coronavirus. Surround them with your healing presence. May we practice social distancing so that we are not a venue for transmission. We pray for healthcare providers on the front lines of this illness. We pray, God, for those whose lives have been turned upside down, those in hospitals and nursing cares and care facilities and their loved ones unable to visit. Teachers, students, support staff, food service workers and restaurant owners, and all those who serve the public in the hospitality industry. None have been spared. All are in need of prayer and support. God of love, we offer prayers for this church at this time as we search for pastoral leadership. Guide the search committee with wisdom and patience in their deliberations. Guide us all that we may take our part, that none may be overburdened. Keep us strong and creatively connected in this time of uncertainty and change. May your still waters calm us and bring us comfort and safety and peace. In the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
May the road rise up to meet you.
May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. The rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand.